Congressman Dent, thank you very much for joining us today. It's a pleasure and honor to have you here on this program. Let's start with your background. You come from a very different background. When I say different, meaning lots of members in Congress, they normally have a law or a business or maybe even some, you know, medicine. Some are doctors. But your background is like, you know, as a salesperson, and then you also worked as a hotel clerk, and then at a university, and then a member of Congress, a successful member of Congress. So how did that happen? I mean, in the land of, we know America is a land of opportunity, but talk about your journey.
I came out of school, like a lot of young people. I graduated high school in 1982. When the unemployment rate in my community was over 12%, which is very high by American standards, and looking for jobs, and I worked for a time as an intern down here. I was paid as an intern, so I guess I was quasi-staff on a temporary basis. Worked here for the member of Congress whose seat I now hold, and then I actually worked as a desk clerk in a hotel. Learned a lot about how to multitask, answer phones, make hotel reservations, check people in, check them out, all at the same time. It was a good experience. Plus, I worked in sales too, as you mentioned. And then I went over to Lehigh University, earned my master's degree at night, like a lot of Americans do. They get their advanced education in the evenings. And then I was elected to the State House, State Senate, then ultimately the U.S. House.
Very good. Very good, interesting journey indeed. Your district is... A lot of people don't know the district per se, but you have some very interesting places in your district, and one of them is the Hershey's Park, and the world famous Hershey's chocolate, which I'm holding it here. So, and it's also, your district is very interesting in the way that it used to be largely Democratic, but about 2 years ago after the redistricting, or we also call it gerrymandering, it became kind of, you know, even. So talk about your district. How is it to represent, as a Republican member of Congress, a district which is not totally or overwhelmingly a Republican district?
Well, yeah, my congressional district prior to the redistricting was a lean Democratic district. After the redistricting, it became sort of a lean Republican district, but it's a marginal district just the same. It's still one of those districts that can swing in either direction. And so I think that's probably true of much of America. It can swing in either direction. So my district, in some respects, better reflects America than many of my colleagues' congressional districts, which tend to be overwhelmingly Republican or overwhelmingly Democrat.
Congressman, a nice segue to this would be your philosophy, your political philosophies, and your voting record. I understand that because of the configuration of your district, you've been, quote-unquote, a moderate Republican. You have voted with the Democrats, and you also have voted with the Republicans. And one very striking, actually, comment that came from you as a member, as a Republican member of Congress, was to give support to the same-sex marriage. And you also voted for don't ask, don't tell policy in the military. So is it because that you have lots of Democrats in the district? Is it because, or is it really something that you believe in, or you change your voting pattern based on the redistricting or the number of Democrats or Republicans in the district?
Well, you mentioned two issues, the repeal of the don't ask, don't tell law, which would allow people who are gay to serve in the military. And the reason I voted to repeal the don't ask, don't tell law is because we ask one of the great qualities or virtues of people who serve in the military, we expect them to be truthful, honest people of integrity. But we were telling gay people not to be truthful. In other words, that they were supposed to conceal their identity. They could serve, but they really weren't allowed to talk about it. And I thought there was sort of a fundamental contradiction in that policy. We expect people to be honest, honorable, and people of integrity, but we were telling gay members who were in the armed services, and there are a lot of them, who were told not to be honest about their sexual orientation. So I felt that was a policy that was a difficult compromise back in 1993 or 1994 when it was first enacted. And at that time, it might have been a more reasonable policy, but over all these years. President Clinton signed a law. But over the years, it seemed that that policy had pretty much outworn its usefulness and was causing more problems than it was resolving. So I thought it was time to end the policy once and for all. And we went through a full service-wide evaluation. There was a survey done by the Joint Chiefs of Staff to interview our men and women serving all over the world and ask them how they felt about a policy change. Could we live with it? And the consensus came back from the men and women of the armed services that they could handle serving with gay service members who were openly gay. So it really didn't seem to be that big of an issue to most of our armed services personnel.
One philosophical question. We see that politicians, especially here in Washington, they tend to change their positions based on survey results, the opinion polls. When you represent a people, you have to make sure that you represent their aspirations, their positions. But at the same time, people also expect leadership. That, you know, if you feel, or as a member of Congress or as a legislator, yes, it's not a good position for the country or for the society as a whole, but predominantly people are in favor. But you understand my point. It's a philosophical question, but
well, you asked the question. Well, in the context of the marriage equality or same-sex marriage issue, in 1996, I was in the Pennsylvania legislature and I voted for the state law, which is called DOMA. The Defense of Marriage Act that defined marriage as a bond between a man and a woman. I voted for it. My constituents, I believe, overwhelmingly supported that position. Well, a lot's changed over those 20 years, where a lot of my constituents, I think, have revisited that position. And in my own state, many of my gay constituents are already married. They were married in the states of New Jersey and New York. And then just a couple months ago, a federal judge ruled that the Pennsylvania law that I voted for in 1996 was unconstitutional. And our governor, a conservative Republican governor, decided he would not appeal the judge's ruling. So what that meant is that gay marriage is now, for all practical purposes, lawful in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. And I simply stated that the judge has ruled. My thinking has evolved. As I said, my constituents, my gay constituents, many of whom are already married, and if two people's idea of happiness is marriage, well, then I don't think that the federal government should stand in the way of them.
So, again, going back to your voting record, a lot of people call you a moderate Republican, and I couldn't help notice a picture of President Obama in your office.
And President
And president, yeah. So, of course, as a Republican, you would have a Republican president's picture. But Obama's picture, who is not very popular with the Republicans, I'm not criticizing it.
But I have two pictures, you're right, in my office. One with President Bush, with my son on my shoulders, and the president talking to him, and it was an interesting conversation. It's a wonderful picture. It was on the White House webpage, and I have another picture with my family with President Obama when we were at the White House to watch the Super Bowl between the Pittsburgh Steelers and the Arizona Cardinals. And so we had a picture with the president. Both of these pictures of the presidents are casual shots, you know, with families, they were not really business shots.
Do you think if you were to have a more prominent role in Congress with these positions that you have, it will help reduce the gridlock in Congress?
Well, I don't know. Look, it's nice to have pictures with presidents. I know many of my colleagues have presidents, pictures with presidents of the opposite party. It's just a fact of life. We interact with them and we have meetings with them from time to time, and that's to be expected in this line of work. But what the American people expect, they expect their members of Congress to work to resolve problems. It's that simple. And when the American public determine that they're going to have a Democratic president, a Democratic Senate, and a Republican House, that means there will be bipartisanship and it will be forced, and it may be messy, it may not be pretty. Many people have said that making laws is like making sausage, and I've often said that would be an insult to sausage, but there's a certain truth to this.
Exactly. Congressman, one more, interesting topic for the audiences is American role in foreign issues. We look around and we see so many issues popping up at the same time, lots of flashpoints. the Middle East, Iraq, Syria, Afghanistan, Pakistan. So do you think, is this a good time for the Americans, for the United States to pull back or get more involved? Or we should also continue to look at our resources. Are we capable of getting involved or intervene in every conflict out there?
No, the United States does not have the capacity to engage itself militarily in every conflict around the world. I mean, our ability to intervene is somewhat limited. But at the same time, I believe the American public and our friends throughout the world expect the United States to be engaged. And it's because we're talking to an overseas audience here today. I want to be careful what I say about the current Obama administration's policies. But some on my side of the aisle, and I would put myself in this category, believe that the Obama administration needs to be a bit more engaged in some of these issues, whether it's in Ukraine or the Middle East or elsewhere. And I'm not talking about putting American troops in harm's way, boots on the ground, so to speak. But I believe we should be much more aggressive in our leadership. Particularly in the Ukraine crisis right now, as an example. Very specifically, I believe the United States need to push our European friends and partners to engage in sectoral-wide sanctions against Russia. And I also believe very strongly, too, that we, the U.S. and the European Union, need to come much closer together economically and on both sides of the Atlantic, work to advance the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, the free trade agreement between the U.S. and the European Union. Bring ourselves closer together economically. That can only advance our national security and our geopolitical and strategic interests by doing so. So there are things that we can do now, and I believe the time has come too, given what the Russians are doing in eastern Ukraine and the separatists that they are funding. I think it's time that we seriously consider arming Ukraine. I mean, providing them the military wherewithal they need to beat back these Russian separatists. I think the time has come. You know, I'm not advocating that Ukraine become part of NATO, but Ukraine certainly should be respected as a sovereign, independent nation. They should be free to make any economic associations they choose. Finland can do the same. Finland can be a part of the EU. They can maintain relations with Russia. We're not arguing that Ukraine should, you know, divorce itself from Russia. They should maintain good relations with Russia. They should maintain relations with the EU. If they choose to go into the European Union, well, that is their choice. That's what sovereign nations do. They make decisions for themselves.
We believe the administration is not doing enough on those points. The administration,
to be fair, has made some steps forward on sanctions, doing some things as it ought to. And to be fair, the administration has been constrained in large part by some of our European friends in Germany, France, and the UK, countries which have been much more reluctant to engage in sectoral-wide sanctions. Yes, they're much more dependent. But and for my state, we want to export more LNG to Europe. That's one reason why we want to advance this trade agreement. We want to help the European Union become much more energy self-reliant on, I'll say, stable and friendly sources like the U.S. and less reliant on unstable, unpredictable, and frankly unfriendly sources like Russia. So we can be doing much, much more, I believe, than has been the case. But in fairness, the administration has been constrained by some of our European partners in Ukraine. But, you know, elsewhere around the world, though, I hear complaints, you know, in the Middle East, too, from some of America's friends that America is too disengaged. You know, on the Syrian crisis, I never advocated that we put boots on the ground. But I thought at one point early on during the Arab Spring that we might consider, you know, helping shape the opposition. But the administration chose more of a policy of disengagement and preferred to have the Turks, the Qataris, the Saudis arm the opposition, which they did. And then came al-Nusra Front, which is metastasized into ISIS. And so one could argue that our disengagement, you know, has led to more problems in Syria. The problem with history is it never shows you the alternatives.
Had they armed or helped them more, the ISIS issue would have basically been much more serious.
I can't imagine that. Well, what we have now is ISIS has overrun, you know, much of northeastern Syria and northwestern Iraq, and so ISIS now has a place to operate from. I could argue too that, you know, you know, I felt too that we as a country need to be more engaged. Now, look, we were largely pulled out of Iraq, But there was a debate at the time about whether or not we should leave some kind of a residual force, 10,000 troops, to maintain some level of influence in Iraq. The country had been largely stabilized at that point at the end of 2008. But the administration, you know, preferred to pull everyone out. Didn't want said they were unable to reach an agreement with Iraq on a status of forces agreement, which I believe they could have reached. But the sad part is that, you know, again, when America is not engaged, vacuums are created, and those vacuums are filled by people and nations and organizations that do not reflect our interests or our values. And that's certainly what's happening right now in much of the Middle East, and particularly in a country like Syria. So I think really the issue has become, America must become much more engaged. And we have not done a very good job as American leaders articulating that American economic freedom and the freedom that so many countries enjoy, you know, the ability to trade with one another, and many countries are prospering, was really established after the Second World War through this rules-based order, which I think many of us have now taken for granted. And it's imperative for people like me to stand up and say that that rules-based order was enforced in large part by a very strong American and Western military presence. We in America have not done a very good job connecting our military strength and superiority with our economic strength. But the two issues, I believe, are very much related. And if we move into a more multipolar world where there are vacuums and where there are where the order may not be enforced, I think that will lead to a more unstable and disorderly world, and one that I would argue would probably be more violent and there'd be more conflicts. I've never seen, since the Second World War, I can't think of a time where there has been so much conflict going on simultaneously. I mean, in the Middle East, you know, Israel and Hamas are fighting, Ukraine and the Russian separatists are fighting. You know, ISIS has taken over a large swath of the Levant,
and Africa,
you know, what's going on Nigeria. In Mali, Boko Haram, and Nigeria. We have problems, of course, Sudan continuing to have trouble. And so we have so many issues right now. Libya still in a state of turmoil. Egypt also still struggling to get their sea legs after the Muslim Brotherhood. So there's a lot of conflict. And
then we're getting ready to withdraw from Afghanistan. That's also making a lot of people nervous in the region. Any thoughts on that? I mean, you know, so, because again, there are talks of disengaging from the area.
Same issue with that. I think that we can learn a lesson in Afghanistan from Iraq. Clearly, when we withdrew from Iraq completely, the vacuum was created. Others moved in to influence the political situation in Iraq. And let's face it, the Iranians had much more influence with Nouri al-Maliki once we left. That was not in America's interest. By the same token, if we leave Afghanistan completely, you know, without a residual force, vacuums will be created, and those vacuums are going to be filled by folks who may not share our interests or our values, and Afghanistan could easily descend back into the types of turmoil and chaos that we found prior to September 11, 2001.
Voice of America, for which I work as a federal employee, and one of the subcommittees that you serve on, the Foreign Operations Subcommittee, you also oversee our operations. And Voice of America is going through a major, major transition. There's a bill on the table. You might be voting on it soon, which is H.R. 4490. And it's going to bring lots of huge changes, basically changing the character of the organization, the composition, the structure. Any thoughts on those ideas, and have you had a chance to go through the entire bill, and how are you going
to vote, if I may ask?
Sure. The legislation that you're referring to would change the structure of the Board of Governors, which is now composed of nine individuals part-time, and essentially change that board and really make the Voice of America an arm for American diplomacy, which is what I thought it always had been during the Cold War, where this is a way for the United States government to use the Voice of America to advance American diplomatic or whatever the particular position was of our country, as opposed to leaving the Voice of America to having local sources and other surrogates, perhaps making the case for America. I think we can have a more refined disciplined message. If we return the voice of America back to what I thought its mission was, which was to really advance the positions of the American government, let the people of Ukraine or Russia, where there are, particularly in Russia, where there are very real restrictions on information, let the voice of America be heard. Let us be that beacon of freedom once again, or that was the case during the Cold War, where so much information was unavailable to folks behind the Iron Curtain. Now, obviously, the world has changed. There are a lot more ways to communicate with people now than there was then. But I do believe that the legislation is well intended, and it's something that I could easily support, and I would support. Because I do think we need to bring a bit more of a discipline in the messaging back to the voice of America. And again, 9 part-time governors, board of governors, is probably
four
not...
Democrats, 4 Republicans.
Yeah, I think it was not... You know, again, it was... I can't say that the voice of America was receiving full-time attention from part-time governors. And I think we need to have people who are going to be dealing with this on a full-time basis, you know, every day, living, breathing, thinking, nothing but Voice of America, and how to advance an American message in parts of the world where it needs to be heard, particularly in a place like Pakistan. I've always said that. You know, we don't do a very good job, we the U.S., in stating our position in a country like Pakistan. We haven't been very good at it, and we need to do better. And so we need to do better, and that's going to take some real work, some discipline. And yes, we can use surrogates too, but we can train the surrogates. And there are all sorts of things we can do to make sure that our messages are heard, because I know in a country like Pakistan, they're hearing a lot of anti-American messages routinely. And there are a lot of people in America, I mean, in Pakistan who, you know, I think who do like America. They do like America. I mean, I've always said in Pakistan, there are those who are pro-American, those who are anti-American, but I feel like the anti-American folks are much more effective at messaging than the pro-American folks, and we need to help the pro-American folks. I've talked with the former ambassador from Pakistan to the U.S., Ambassador Haqqani, about that quite a bit. You know, we need to have a pro-American voice, not just in Pakistan, but throughout the world, hearing our message, and hopefully from people who can speak the language of the, you know, whether it's Urdu or whatever the language may be. We want to make sure that that language is, they're communicating in that language, and hopefully with people, you know, who are of that country, can make the case for us.
Do you believe that there are ample guarantees to protect the journalists and their work as journalists in this bill, rather than just being, someone who can just, you know, give them the U.S. position? They should also, I mean, there are provisions in the bill, very strong, and a lot of people believe that, yes, there are guarantees that they will continue to work as a journalist.
Well, yeah, well, I believe we have to make sure that our journalists are going to be able to behave professionally, and try to also, where particularly appropriate, to provide that balanced discussion on whatever the issue may be. But it's also completely appropriate for the United States government to have its position advocated, but we can still do that in the context of having a balanced discussion, the pros or the cons on a given issue. Here's what the American government is, and why we the American government believe the way they do. But we can accept debate and disagreement in the United States, and we can certainly hear the other side in the same conversation. But it's most important they at least hear our side. We're not against others presenting their views. We just want to make sure that our side is presented fairly and objectively, and we're happy to have that debate with those who may disagree with us.
Very well. Congressman, we were talking about local issues, and then, of course, we went overseas about locally. I mean, there was an unfortunate shooting in Pennsylvania yesterday, not in your district, but close to your district. Again, and this has been a major issue, a very controversial issue, the gun control that I'm referring to. And you've been seeing these shootings so very often. As a moderate Republican, what's your position on this gun control issue?
Well, as an American, as a Pennsylvanian, I do believe in the right for citizens to own firearms and to bear arms. I mean, we have a Constitution that guarantees it. The Second Amendment says there shall be a right to bear arms. And it has been affirmed that that is an individual right. At the same time, when we have rights, we have responsibilities. And while we have rights to own firearms, we also have responsibilities to make sure our firearms are secure, and that we not deliver them to people who ought not have them, or who are, you know, who are mentally unstable, or, you know, who are, or who are children who might find ways into their parents' gun lockers, or wherever they store them. But I would argue that, and it is reasonable to have background checks. We have background checks. In my state, we already have background checks for individuals who purchase firearms. We basically require that anybody who's been convicted of a violent felony, or anybody who has been adjudicated or involuntarily committed into a mental health institution, you know, will lose their ability to purchase a firearm. Now, that said, you know, we can expand those background checks to include private sales, as we do in Pennsylvania. If you buy if you and I were to make a transaction, or I were to sell you a pistol, we would have to go to a federally licensed firearm licensee and or the county sheriff's office to
any
effectuate the
concerns,
transaction.
Since you're also on subcommittee for Homeland Security, where we stand, do you see, you know, major issues still facing this country, even though, you know, there's been a lot of legislation done, you know, executive branch has done a lot of work on this. So what are your concerns when it comes to Homeland Security?
Well, there are so many issues. I think now that ISIS has taken a foothold in much of the Middle East, that there is a great fear that these terrorist organizations now have a base from which to operate. We see foreign fighters coming from Europe, in particular, coming into Syria and Iraq. They will be trained, battle-hardened, and returning home at some point. And so there is great fear that there will be a new wave of, I'll say, Islamist extremist terrorism that could be headed our way once again. So we are very vigilant. The threats are real. We're also very concerned about cyber attack. There's no question that one of our greatest fears here is the next, a major cyber attack on American infrastructure, whether it be financial services, energy, telecommunications. There is a great fear, and we have not done a particularly good job explaining the role that the National Security Agency, or the NSA, plays in helping us defend ourselves against such attacks. And finally, since I'm on Homeland Security, there's also we have a border crisis occurring right now, and a humanitarian crisis where we have tens of thousands of unaccompanied children coming up to our border from Central America, and those children are being resettled. Some of whom are in my district. I just visited one of the Office of Refugee Resettlement facilities in my area. And these children are being resettled. These poor children, as young as I saw a young 5-year-old girl. But she's going to be reunited with her family. And many of their families are already in the United States. And so we have to change our laws, one, to help provide for the safety and security of these children who are now in our custody, and treat them humanely. And at the same time, we have to send a message to Central America that, you know, many of these children are going to be returned. They want their children back, and we're going to have to return them safely. And so we have to change our laws to make sure that individuals coming into the United States from Central America will likely be treated the same way as they would be if they were from Mexico or Canada and crossed the border illegally, where we can have an expedited hearing and review process and then return them much more quickly.
Congressman, everybody agrees that immigration system is broken and it needs serious reforms, but there's a sharp schism between the positions of either party. I mean, they can't agree what needs to be done. Something needs to be done, but what it is. Do you agree with the administration's position that, you know, yes, we need reforms, to what extent? And I think President Obama is trying to deport these kids. That's just one position, but the larger issue is a broken immigration system. What needs to be done?
Well, you're correct in your assessment. The immigration system in America is largely broken. And we have to we must repair the legal system in order to slow down illegal immigration. The two issues are very much related, legal and illegal immigration. If there are unrealistic paths to lawful entry into the United States, people will end up in the United States unlawfully. Remember that between one-third to one-half of the individuals who are in the United States illegally entered legally. That is, they came with a visa in hand, they came in through the front door, and they overstayed, and they never left. And so and part of that might be that, you know, we need to develop some kind of a metric where we have visas for work visas for whatever purpose, whether it's for lower skilled people working in agriculture or in landscaping to the highest skills in science, technology, engineering, and math. We must make sure that the caps are sufficiently high to meet whatever the labor need. And that cap can fluctuate. If the economy is good, you know, it can be a little higher. If the economy is weaker, it can be lowered. But the point is, we need to develop a metric that is realistic so that we can allow enough lawful entry. Because if people, if they're here illegally, what will happen is some of them would like to go home, but they can't go home if they're here illegally, because then they can't get back into the country. So their incentive then is to bring their family up here with them. So we need to fix the legal system. And I'll be the first to tell you that we have about around 11 or 12 million people in this country unlawfully. And it is not a practical solution to deport all of them. I mean, my state, Pennsylvania, is nearly 13 million people. And that would be, think of deporting the entire Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. There's not really a practical or humane way to do that. So, but we must secure our border. And you know, with what's happening now on the southern border with the children, I think is just proof positive that we must move aggressively to secure our border. But at the same time, you know, deal with the realities of, you know, we need to deal with the agricultural issues, you know, agricultural work issues. The advanced skill workers. I mean, I know that a person who's coming to our country from India with a PhD in mechanical engineering will, if they are allowed to stay in the United States, not only will they be productive, but they will likely not only employ themselves, but others, and that they will contribute to our country. And so we need to make sure that those people with those advanced skills who will be productive have accelerated paths, to lawful entrance or green cards. And so there are changes that we need to make on border security, interior enforcement. We need to demonstrate to the American people that we are going to operate under the rule of law. Once we do that, then we can deal with these other issues of how do we properly dispose how do you handle, you know, 11 million people who are here unlawfully, and then we can have that conversation.
Congressman Charles Dent, thank you very much for talking to us on a range of very wide range of issues. It's a pleasure to have you on the show. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.